Well, good morning. Oh, y'all can do better than that. Good morning. How is everybody this morning?
Yeah, I was just telling Debbie yesterday, my son told me it was the first day of fall. Looks like the weather's changing a little bit. It's getting a little nice in the mornings out there now. We got a little bit of up-and-coming events. October the 5th at 11:30 a.m., ladies' birthday luncheon, Longhorn Steakhouse. I'm going to say that right, Miss Sailor. If you need anything, ask Janet. She knows everything about the ladies. Men's huddle coming up on October the 5th at 6:30. All you men are invited. We meet up here. We bring something to eat. We do the same thing women do, except we make a bigger mess than they do. Join us for devotion, food, and fellowship. October the 6th and the 7th. Church-wide yard sale, see Gene Wissenant and Carolyn Ashby if you want to set up a booth. Okay, October the 29th from 4 to 6, Hallelujah Night. Chili cook-off begins at 3 p.m. Donations needed, candy and other stuff. We'll have areas out in the foyer or in the back if you want to donate candy or anything for that Hallelujah Night that's coming up. Other, you know, we do it every year. We've got so much going on in this church, y'all just don't know. It's huge. It's massive. It's God. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity of being in your house another day, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for all the folks that are out there watching right now on the network, Lord. We pray for them. We pray for their needs. We pray for all the unspokens. We pray for the people that have physical and spiritual needs, Lord. Lord, again, let us be obedient in what you want us to do, Father. Show us our way. Give us our pathway. Forgive us where we failed you. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Will you stand with me, please? We'll sing together. Worship with three verses of He Keeps Me Singing.
Thank you.
my husband's favorite song, Victory in Jesus. We'll sing all three verses.
His precious.
you stand with me once again, please? We're going to sing three verses of On Jordan's Stormy Banks. Something about that name.
Father God in heaven, Lord, we are grateful that there's something special about that name, Lord. Thank you for Jesus, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to come and at this time in our service, Lord, to give, Lord, to sacrificially give, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to give, Lord. We ask you to bless the gift and the giver, Lord. Thank you for the blessings you give us. In the name of Jesus, we ask these favors. Amen.
Thank you. before I sing this song, I just want to say a few words. A lot of you know that last year I had cancer, and after surgery and a year worth of treatment, I'm now cancer-free. And during all the time I was going through all that trouble and tribulation, I just prayed, dear Lord, if it be your will, take it away. But dear Lord, if it's not your will, then someday it will be morning for me. And that's the name of this song, is Come Morning. God's children too long have been burdened. They are longing for heaven's green shore, where heartaches are left far behind them, and burdens are carried no more. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest near the evergreen tree. I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Sometimes I'm despised and rejected, and I question, Father, how long? Then I take one more look at my Calvary, and it gives me the strength to go home. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest near the evergreen tree. I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest near the evergreen tree. And I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Come morning, there's glory for me.
Service. So if you'll stand with me once again, we're going to sing a verse of Just Over in the Glory Land. And then after that, we'll take a few moments to greet everyone and make sure they're welcomed, and just say hi. I've a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land. The happy angel band, just over in the glory land, just over in the As the children go to children's church, let's take a moment to greet one another. With the blood-washed throng, I will shout and sing just over in the glory land. Glad hosannas to Christ the Lord and King just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join.
I forgot something this morning, y'all, and that's my fault. I went R&R last week, and I've just forgot everything. On the back side of your tear-out portion of your bulletin, there's always something there to put your name on if this is your first time visiting, or if you have a prayer need or something. The offering plates are out there by the door on your way out. If you'll drop that in there, we very much appreciate that as a praying church. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, now comes the time of Mylon, Lord, as he brings your word, Father. Let it be afresh. Let it be anew, Lord. Let it be another day of what we need to hear from you, Lord. Father, the people that are out there watching online and everything, Lord, we know their needs, Father. Let Mylon be today, as these altars are always open, Lord. Let him bring your words that we need to get through this day, Father. Forgive us where we failed you. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you have your Bibles, you join me this morning in God's Word in the Gospel of John, chapter 15. The Gospel of John, chapter 15. As you're turning there, I'm going to say a couple quick things. Paula wanted us to remember her son today. He's preaching at Mount Calvary. Is it Calvary Church? So be praying for him. He didn't have an opportunity to preach often, but be praying for him this morning. But also, as we've told y'all before, we're fixing it's a little different kind of a church directory we were going to put on. But we're trying to put it together, a church directory. And Tanya told me that starting next Sunday, it's first Sunday in October, all throughout October, she's going to be catching y'all on your way out. We're going to have a little place set up out there. Just take a quick picture of everybody so that we can have a little directory we're going to make up so that you're going to know who everybody is. Because I assure you, I bet there's not one person in this room that can go around here and tell you who everybody is. So God's been blessing us with a lot of new faces. And so if you want to lose any weight before next week, you got 1 week to do it, okay? I figure I don't have much time to work on that, but if I'm going to look a little slimmer, I'm going to have to work hard. So put that on your calendars, and we'll be doing that throughout the month of October. This morning, I'd like to talk about a friend of God. In chapter 15, verse 13 of John, it said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for a servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you." I like to be known today, and I hope to be known today by one of God's friends. I hope that you can say that God today is your friend. If we talk about friends, we need to know one thing, that it takes both to be in agreement that you're friends. I mean, I'll be honest, when I was a teenager and I was growing up, there was a lot of girls I wanted to be friends with me, and they said, "No, I'm not your friend." It takes both of them to be in alliance. God's already made the first move. God says, "I want to be your friend." And I want to talk a little more about that. It says in Proverbs 18:24, "A man that has friends must show himself friendly. There is a friend that is closer than a brother." We must do our part. If we want God to be our friend, we must be friendly to God. We have to follow his direction and his will for our lives. And I want to tell you this about friends. Friends sort of define who we are. Your mom, dad ever tell you growing up, you need to quit hanging with the wrong crowd. In other words, they wanted you to have friends that were a little higher up as far as behavior goes. Staying out of trouble. So are we with the right kind of friend today? Being a friend of God sort of changes my other friends too. I become part of a body of believers, of friends that are friends with the Lord. You know, if you were to come, well, let me say this. I go to my grandkids' birthday parties a little bit just to make my appearance because they want me to leave after I brought my gift. When you go, you see all their friends. So you sort of hang out. You get to know people because they're friends of my family. James said it this way, "And the scriptures was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. So Abraham was known as a friend of God. And here we recognize, we talk about a friend as well. Being a friend of God, in 1 Corinthians 6:19 says, "Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Once we become a friend of God, we need to understand he's done a lot to become my friend. He purchased me to be his friend. Can you imagine that, somebody paying you to be their friend? Well, he pretty much paid us to be his friend. He paid off our debts. I mean, some of y'all out there, I know you've got a house note. If Mike were to come and pay off your note, you can say he's your friend, wouldn't you? I mean, he paid a debt that you had, because he got you out of debt. That's one of the ways God became our friend. He paid our debt. He paid a debt that we could not owe, or we could not pay ourselves, that we owed. I took a lady once, I may have shared this before, a little lady from our church that I was pastoring. I seen her getting her mail out of her mailbox, and I was on the way to take my wife out for dinner. And my wife, I told her, "Come on, take you out for dinner." She said, "Let me get my purse." I said, "No, I'm buying your dinner. Come on." So she gets in the truck, and we're going to the restaurant. And I seen this little lady from my church, and I pulled over, and she's getting her mouth. I said, "Come on, I'm taking you with us. We're going to dinner." She said, "Well, come on." I said, "Get in the truck." She said, "Let me get my purse." I said, "No, you don't need your purse. Get in the truck." She said, "I'm getting my purse, preacher." So she got her purse, she got in the truck, and we got there, and we ordered, and I left my billfold at home. I'm glad she got her purse. Now, she paid that debt that I had, or somebody was going to have to be doing a lot of stammering and stuttering and probably doing a lot of dishes that day. She still didn't let me down on that. I told that story when I did her funeral, that she paid for my meal. I said everybody at church teased her from that point on, said, "Miss Effie was her name. Miss Effie, you fell for that?" He's pulled out on everybody in the church. But it's good to have somebody pay your debt, isn't it? The Lord has paid our debt that we didn't have money to pay. For that, I can call him my friend. He purchased my debt with his blood. Now, it's one thing to be able to throw pennies out there, but your blood, that's something special, isn't it? That's something special. I mean, I see people all the time, I give them a couple bucks, that's all they need. But my blood, he shed his blood, gave his life. He pardoned me for my debt. He purified me. You know, a lot of times we're trying to fix ourselves, make ourselves a better kind of person or a better kind of friend to him, but he's the one that purifies us. He's the one that makes us who we are today. I can't take credit for it. God is the one that's in charge. Every church that I've pastored, it was God doing the work. God's doing the work here at Brindley Mountain Baptist Church. I'm going to let you know that real quick. It's nothing that the preacher can ever do. It's something that God does. And I look at these young folks, and I look at new faces, and I'm just so thankful for what God can do. God's the one that blesses us. He is my friend. He preserves us. He protects us, because I promise you, Satan wants to destroy us. But he's our protector. He's our provider. He's the one that keeps Satan away from us. He puts his head. He's the one that in our house here today, the old devil, he's that old wolf out there huffing and puffing and wanting to blow our house in. God is our protector. You know why? Because he's my friend. He's your friend. Not only does he do all those kind of things, and we got to think about what kind of friend is the Lord to us today. There's all kind of friends. There's friends that are acquaintances. Yeah, well, I sort of know some of you, but if I came home seeing you sitting in my living room, I might think, what are you doing here? I mean, just how close a friend are you? There's work friends, people we work with at work. There's casual friends, and then we have those that's close friends. You may have some friends that may even have a key to your house. They go by and get stuff out of your shop because they're your friends. They come water your plants while you're on vacation. They're your friends. In fact, there's such thing as a person that's called your best friend. Can we say that God is our best friend today? Well, a lot of us can say that, but I go back to the point, it takes both of us. Would God call you his best friend? Would he look at us today and consider us as his best friend? Well, I don't know if he would call me his best friend or not. Folks, it takes both of us. We both need to be involved. In fact, in Gospel of Luke 14, it says, "And the Lord said unto his servants, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled." God wants his house to be filled. And if he wants his house to be filled, and I'm his best bud and I'm his best friend, I need to be doing that. I mean, I need to be out there working at getting his house filled, bringing folks in, inviting folks. You know, a lot of times we sort of get on the boat until it starts getting personal. There's a preacher that's preaching one Sunday. He's preaching at his church, and his church was a little more charismatic than you guys. He's up there preaching. He said, if we're going to follow the Lord and do what God wants us to, as a church, we got to begin to walk. And old preacher's out there, let the church walk, preacher, let the church walk. And the preacher preaches on a little bit further, says, if we're going to follow the Lord, we may have to go from running, walking to running. It's time for the church to start running. He said, preach it, preacher. Preach, run. We need to run. Church, we need to run. He goes on a little further, and he said, you know, walking's good, running's good, but as a church, to fulfill God's purpose in our lives, we must fly. We must fly. He said, let the church fly, preacher. Let the church fly. He says, guys, you know, if we're going to fly, we're going to cost us some money. So Dickens starts saying, let us crawl, preacher, let us crawl. I don't know if we want to be spending our money. He gets a little personal, but God expects us to give our all because he gave his all. That's what a true friendship is. It's not a one-sided thing. And he goes into that in verse 1 of this chapter. He said, I am the true vine. My Father is a husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now, as we look at the stories he tells us, the first thing his expectation is fruit. His expectation is fruit. That's what he wants of his friends. He says, we're branches. You know the difference between a branch and a stick? A lot of people have come to God's house and we're nothing but a stick. We're not producing fruit. If we're still clinging to the vine and we're the branches, he's going to give us the nourishment that we need to produce fruit. And as long as we're clinging to the vine, being a friend to the vine, we're going to produce fruit. But all of a sudden the storms come up and they blow on the trees and upon the vine. If you've ever been around my house after a big wind, you got to go out and pick up sticks. And usually it's those sticks that didn't really have life in them anyway, just need a little something to blow them off. I hate to tell y'all, that happens to churches all the time. Where a little wind comes up, and those branches that do not have life in them, they're not clinging very deeply to the Lord. They fall to the ground. They fall to the ground. They're not clinging together as a friend, as a branch should be to the vine. And what did he say? She did to him in verse 2. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he does what? He takes it away. What do you do in your yard when the sticks fall to the ground? You take them and you burn them. That's what I do. They're no good to me anymore. Laying on the, You know, you're not going to drive by the preacher's house and say, oh, man, he's got a pretty yard of sticks out there. You know, you're not going to say that. It has no value. We got way too many churches today. There's a bunch of sticks laying around. It's not producing fruit. And that's not God's plan for our lives. He wants to clean things up. It belongs to God. We're friends of His. He goes on to say, not only does He take away, but He purges. He purges. One thing about God's always taking away our old life and gives us new life. So many times as Christians today, as friends of God today, we want to talk about what we did in the past. God purges that away. I had a guy telling me, he said, man, let me show you something. I went and visited him. He wasn't in church or nothing, and he wasn't really serving the Lord in any kind of capacity. But as I went to witness to him a little bit, he got telling me all the things he's done. He got out a notebook. He said, I want you to look at this notebook where I taught Sunday school back 30 years ago. Here's my outlines. Look at all this stuff I've done. You know what that is? That sticks. It's in the past. What are we doing now? What are we doing now? Because God doesn't want our sticks. He wants the fruit to prosper. That's what being a friend of God does. We need to be doing our part. He does purge us. He takes away things, and He does it right through, He says, verse 3, with His Word. His Word. That's why I need to get in God's Word. That's why you need to be in God's Word, because it cuts away all those things out of our lives so that we can produce fruit. And we're producing those fruits that He wants us to produce. Guess what? We're in fellowship with our friends. You ever had friends that you, man, y'all were just best buds, maybe going up through school and maybe got out and got something. Maybe somebody done something. Now you're not friends anymore. So you are you and Sam buddies? Well, we used to be. Well, something's happened. Well, I assure you this morning, if we're not producing fruit, something's happened between you and the Lord. Something's happened. He's not stopped providing. He's stopped loving. It's us not doing what we should. We're not abiding. That's what He says in verse 4. Abide in Me, and I in you. If you abide in Me, I'll abide in you. As the branch cannot bear forth fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can you except you abide in Me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in Me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without Me, you can do nothing. Without the Lord and being clinging to Him, we're not going to accomplish anything. Folks, that means our church isn't going to be prosperous. Your home's not going to be prosperous. Your family's not going to be prosperous. Your life's not going to be prosperous. A lot of people are going around not being prosperous, and they blaming it on God. He's already done His part, but what are we doing in our part to be the friend to Him? If we're doing what we should with the Lord, it's going to grow. We're going to abide. That word abide is mentioned 9 times in this chapter, 9 times. It's important that we're clinging to the Lord. Too many people are casual friends of God today. We're not clinging. That's not our heartbeat. We're separated. I like my legs. Now, y'all may look at my leg and say, you've got some ugly legs, preacher. You may say that. But they're pretty precious to me. They're precious to me. If you were to separate my legs from me, I'm going to miss them. I'm going to miss them. Folks, the Lord's missing you today if you're not where you need to be. And not only will I miss it, it'll have a lot to do with what I can do if my legs are missing. We are a body of believers here today. We all have one thing in common. is the vine, Jesus Christ. And when we become separated, it affects the whole body. The whole body. You say you're not much? I would show you my leg, but I don't want to do that. But you're necessary to do what God wants to do in this body of believers. And being a friend of the Lord, ugly, naughty, you're special. You're God's friend. So we must abide with him, because if we're not abiding with him, we cannot accomplish anything. We are nothing if we're not abiding with him. When we break our fellowship and our friendship with the Lord, we're in chaos. We have problems. I have people come to me all the time saying, "Preacher, you know, God must not love me because God's not blessing me." Well, it may not be God that's the problem here. In fact, I'll say, go a step further and say, he is not the problem. We've stopped abiding with him. Today, if you don't feel that your life has been accomplished, you're not fulfilling the purpose that you think is too up to its potential. We just need to abide with the Lord today. He's already made the first step. It goes on to say a little bit further. He said, if, that is a big word, isn't it? If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If we're not going to cling to him, we have no value. Folks, I keep sharing week after week, to be part of the body of believers, we've got to abide with Christ. And if we're abiding with Christ, we're going to be productive. We're going to be fruitful. We're going to enjoy the fruits. But he said, if you abide in me and your words abide in, my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so much you be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you continually, or continue you in my love. If we abide in him, we can go ask him anything. Have you ever had a friend that you could call and ask them to do something and they wouldn't do it? If a total stranger were to call me at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, "Preacher, will you come to Florida and pick me up? I'm out of gas." I'm going to say, "What?" But if it's a friend, if old Jeff would call me and said, "Preacher, I hate to bother you, but I'm out of gas. I'm down here in Florida. I have no money. Can you come?" I'd be getting my britches on, because it's a friend. You do things for people that are friends. More so, I go a step further. If somebody just knocks on my door and said, "Look, I don't have no way to get to work today. Can I borrow your truck?" You better be a friend, or you ain't getting my truck. And not only a friend, you better be a good friend to get my truck. If we're going to get the blessings from God, we got to be a friend. We got to be a good friend. And when we're a good friend, there's nothing. I got a dad, I love him to death, and we're friends. I've had my truck, it was in the shop one time, and I said, "Dad, my truck's in the shop, and I'm going to see if they give me a loaner." I said, "No, they ain't going to give you a loaner. I'll give you a truck." He got a truck for everything, you know. He said, "I'll let you have one of my trucks. Keep it as long as you want." Why does he do that? Because we're friends. I'm thinking, well, I might scratch it. Well, so what? We're friends. We're friends. Look, the Lord's going to bless us if we're his friends. We can ask him anything we want to ask him. And within his power, he can give it to you. My dad, bless his heart, going back to my dad for a moment, I was in the hospital for 19 days several years ago and had a little problem with my colon. My dad, he'd come up there, and he'd want to do everything he can for me. He'd come up there trying to give me money. I said, Dad, I don't need no money. Here's $10,000. I don't need $10,000, Dad. Well, you're not getting to work. I said, the church ain't going to quit paying me just because I'm in the hospital. He just wanted to do something for me. He wanted to do something for me. He'd come up there every morning. My wife would be there all night long. He, you know, he'd tell my wife, you go home. I got this. You know, he wanted to do things for me. God wants to do stuff for you today. You know why? Because he is your friend. But what kind of friend are we to him? What kind of friend? He says in verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. That's sort of condition, isn't it? You're going to abide in his love as long as we're following his commandments. A lot of people aren't following his commandments. If we're not following God's directions for our lives, we're out of luck. You shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. It goes on to say, these things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Folks, I promise you, if people are friends of the Lord, it ought to be evident on our faces, isn't it? I preached in a lot of churches, it was evident a lot of people weren't friends with God because they didn't look like they were very happy. You know? If we're friends of God, our joy is full. It makes us sing a little differently. Them Alabama folks, they were singing a lot better than the Auburn folks were yesterday. You know what I'm saying? When you're in fellowship with God, you sing a little differently. You have joy in your heart. I know that there's some folks watching, and some folks even in this room, that your joy isn't what it maybe used to be. Your joy may be lacking today. But I'm going to tell you, he's already done his part to make your friendship what it ought to be. We must do what we're supposed to do and abide with him. Follow his command, and our joys will be made full. What kind of friend are we today? We may go through a lot of valleys, but folks, it's okay to go through a valley as long as you've got a friend. If it's cancer, Pat shared about, as long as God's your friend going through it, you're in good shape, aren't you? You remember Joseph? He went through a lot of stuff in his life, and he probably thought, I can't get any good breaks. But I'm going to tell you something. Joseph had a good friend, even though he sold into slavery, even though he was thrown into prison, God was still his friend. It goes on in this chapter. I don't have time to go through it. It said, they persecuted me. They'll persecute you. You're going to go through some things. But we're going to go through it together because we have a friend. Maybe our friendship is in trouble today because we're not following his plans in our life. We're not abiding with him as closely as we should. It's time for us to abide so that our joy can be full. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we're so thankful of your friendship. We're so thankful for what you've done for our friendship. And I pray, Lord, if there's one here today that can't call you friend, I pray, Lord, before they leave here today, somebody even watching, I pray that they can say, he is my friend. And I pray, Lord, not only can we all say that you are a friend, I hope today that you can look at our lives and say that we're your friend. And I pray if there's anything that hinders that statement from you today, I pray we lay it at your feet to forgive us of our past. And I pray that we abide with you as we leave here today. I pray, Lord, that we cling to you as friends. In Jesus' name we pray and ask. Amen. If you stand together this morning, then we can go home the same way we came. But I pray that if you can't say that he's your friend. I pray that you can say it when you leave today. And I pray when we walk out the door today that the Lord says, there goes my friend. I hope that you can say that today. If not, he can make it possible for you today. Let us sing.
I wandered far.
Have we got away from being his friend? Maybe today we need to come home.
Now I'm coming home.
If you need to lay it on the altar, if you need me to pray with you, whatever you need to do, you come. A lot of folks that need to come home to the Lord today.
Never more to roam. Open wide thy arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home.
Amen. What a joy it is being in God's house today. And I hope that each and every one of you can call yourself friends of the Lord today. Brother Mike, if you'd come forward. Mike has been coming regular here. Mike Moreland, is that correct?
Yes.
He'd like to move his membership from Cross Point over in Madison to Brenly Mountain Baptist Church. What is your wish? The church. All right. I'll have a second. Second. All in favor, uplift your hand and say amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask him to stay here with us. And also, I got another young lady over here. She's a little shy. This is Reagan. She's one of the special girls here today. But she'd asked the Lord to save her about a year or so ago. But she hadn't followed through baptism, but she wanted to make sure we understood everything. But she's come today for believer's baptism. What is the wish of the church? Amen. Have a second of that. Everybody in favor, by lifting a hand and saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I know she's shy, and I know she won't stay here, but I want you to come by and greet both of them today and let them know you're going to be praying for them and how delighted we are for the fruits that God is providing for Brenly Mountain Baptist Church. We thank you for coming today. Anyone else have a word before we dismiss? Brother Darrell, dismiss us in prayer, please, sir.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for all the many blessings, Lord. Thank you for the ones that's come, Lord. We welcome them with open arms, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for Jesus Christ, Lord, for the gift of eternal life, Lord. Lord, go with us through our home. Forgive us of our sins and when we fail thee. In your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.